Hello, everyone, and welcome to Microsoft Build. I'm so happy that all of you are joining us today for our session on practical machine learning and MLOps with Azure ML. My name is Shané Winner, and I'm a senior product manager on the Azure Machine Learning team. And I'm joined by my colleagues, Ami and Alex, who you're going to hear from in a few moments. And today we have a really exciting agenda. I'm first going to start off and talk a little bit about what exactly is Azure Machine Learning and how does it fit in our Azure AI ecosystem. And then we have not one, not two, but three very exciting demos. And I know what some of you are thinking. We need more demos, right? But today we just had three. That's all the time we got. But we're going to dive right into the demo. I'm going to make the introduction super short and sweet and not boring so that we could see the really exciting stuff. And then at the end, we're going to see what our customers are doing with Azure Machine Learning. All right, let's get started. So what is Azure Machine Learning? Azure Machine Learning, or Azure ML, is an end-to-end managed platform that allows you to build, train, and deploy your machine learning models securely, responsibly, and at scale. So whether you like to use your own custom model, or open source, or open AI model, it doesn't matter. We don't care. You could use whatever you want. And the best part is, you can use whatever framework. You like TensorFlow, PyTorch, you name it. And you could run it from wherever you want, whether it's on the cloud, on-premise, a hybrid, or an edge. You can run your MLOps process securely and responsibly with Azure Machine Learning. And our AI is embedded across Microsoft. So teams like Office and Bing are using Azure Machine Learning every single day to run their workloads. So I'm sure you have seen, like in Outlook, when you see those smart replies, you could just click it and it's easy, you don't need to write an email. That's leveraging Azure Machine Learning. And even more recently, you might have seen the release of Copilot that is powered by OpenAI's ChatGPT. And you could find that across Microsoft products such as Bing and M365. So every day, millions of users, like on Office, for example, they are on Office using Azure Machine Learning in the back end and really validating the scale and performance of our platform. And this is something that you can all benefit and leverage as well. And with our AI stack, you can start as high as you want and really go as low as you need. And as promised, I'm done with my introduction. Short and sweet, right? And we are ready to get started with our first demo. And I'm gonna call up Ami in a few seconds to talk more about it. And what you'll see is we have a few really exciting features to introduce today. So we're gonna start from the very beginning, where we're gonna create a secure workspace. And this workspace is important because we're going to be training a custom credit card fraud detection model. And then we're going to train that model, visualize the results, register it, and then deploy it to production and monitor that model in the wild. And without further ado, I'm going to bring up Ami.
Thank you, Shané. I'm now excited. Oh, thanks, everyone. So I'm going to just get right into it. We're going to train our custom machine learning model. We're a bank, so we're going to, you know, we want to make sure we're going to detect our credit card fraud. And to add some context, because we're in the bank industry, it's important that our workspace and your models are secure and yes, protected. So let's just get right into the demo video. Okay. You can see here that I've already filled out all the basic details around creating our workspace. And now we can kind of go into talking about networking. Azure ML Managed Network Isolation is a brand new feature that is now in public preview. And it provides the highest level of security while simplifying the setup and configuration. There are just two options available for you. You just need to set either internet outbound or approved outbound. Most of us may lean to set up towards internet outbound, but because we're a banking industry, we need to make sure we prioritize the utmost security, so we're gonna go with that option. What that does is it simplifies how the connection between Azure ML compute and the dependency resource through private link. Azure ML will create this private link on behalf of the users, and as IT admins, you can do advanced settings if you need be. So with just these few steps and clicks, you've now reviewed and created your secure workspace. Wasn't that just so easy? I now can go ahead and just get started into training that credit card fraud detection model. Nice. Now I'm in the Azure Studio UI in that secure workspace, and I want to go get started in training that model. So what I can go do from here is, hold up, I'm missing something. Data. My data's not connected yet. It's in an external database, Snowflake. And maybe many of you may have your data in like Snowflake, S3, or Synapse Analytics. So let's get that data. I'm gonna go to Compute, where I have my personal CI, my workstation, and I'm gonna navigate to VS Code Web seamlessly through that connection. And I already have my personal CI connected. I can make that connection to Snowflake. And from here, I can leverage the Azure ML data import that's now in public preview. And within two lines of code, I'm importing my data from Snowflake into Azure ML. I can click into Azure ML Studio where I see the data import. And then by just refreshing, I can see the output data. So now I have successfully created my data asset that is from Snowflake into Azure ML. How cool. So now that I've brought in my data from Snowflake, I now can go open up my notebook that was reading that local data in VS Code Web. I can switch that code where I was referencing the local code and call that data asset. Now I'm ready to turn this notebook into a script. And I can see here, with the help of VS Code Web that is now in public preview, I can easily debug this script using the cells I had previously or at different breakpoints. VS Code Web also offers me rich source control. And from here, as soon as I save my script and I'm ready to go towards submitting my training job, I can leverage the Azure ML extension to create a job where I want to create a command job. And then I see that there's a YAML template pre-filled and created for me. Here, I notice that there is serverless compute, which means I don't need to manage, create, delete any of the compute. I can just remove this line. Now I can just get into what really matters. It's just setting up that training job with the inputs and outputs I need. And from here, I can also leverage the intelligence of VS Code's IntelliSense to add the environment I need. And once all that's done, I can just get started into submitting this job with the execute YAML button on the top right. In the terminal, I see that the code is running and that I will have the link to the studio job where I can navigate back to the studio UI. And I'm gonna open that. And here, I now see that same training job running in Azure ML. Cool. So from here, I'm gonna wait for this job to finish running. Then I wanna evaluate those metrics once it's done. Now that it's completed, I can do that by navigating to the metrics tab. Here, I see that there's the accuracy score, the F1 score, the log loss. And because I'm trying to detect, you know, credit card fraud, I wanna minimize as much loss as possible. So I wanna go ahead and iterate over these results. I can change different parameters to do so and leverage perform sweep as well. This may take some time, so what I've done just so we can get ahead of the curve is I've submitted some jobs across many of these different parameters, and now I'm just gonna go into my experiment where I have all these results. I can see that I'm now using the new improved experiment tracking tools that's now in public preview. I see that I've landed on a new dashboard view where I can visualize all of my training results. I can see how all the different iterations of these jobs have performed. And I can then see there's the different colors that correlate to those jobs. I now can hover over and see that Joyful Bean is the highest performing training result, and even change the color of that job from purple to, let's say, orange by just clicking on the side bar and using the color canvas. I can also add a note for my team, letting them know why that this is the best result and how the metrics are performing. That way, when they land on this view, they quickly understand what's going on and see why I want to go ahead and proceed with that model. What I'll do is I'm going to click add a tile and add a markdown. I'm going to add my training notes. I'm going to add, and I can use the markdown preview to see how those viewed and see that I'm writing that Joyful Bean has the best training result, and I'm going to register this as a credit card model. Really easy to add the markdown tile, and now I can save this view going to the view options and click save and then share. Now my team has access to this dashboard view, and now I can proceed with doing as I said so, is registering this as a credit card fraud model. To do that, I'll go to the job details page, click the register model button, and then I will see that my model information has already been filled out and the outputs have been because it was already connected to my job. And so all I really need to do at this point is add the name, credit card fraud. From here, I have registered my model, but I'm not done just yet. I've been working in my training workspace, and my team needs to access this model in their production workspace. So I'm going to do so by leveraging registries, which is now GA. Through registries, I can share this model to the Build 2023 registry, where my teammate can then leverage this model in their production workspace. I now can see that I've shared this model to the registry, and it's ready to go to production. So what I'm going to do now is hand it off to Alex, who will now show you how to deploy your model.
Thanks, Ami. Hi, I'm Alex. Deploying a model to production isn't easy. Out of a show of hands, who here has experienced any sort of challenge when trying to bring your models to production? I see plenty of hands. It's not easy to do. Well, today, I'm going to show you how to safely and securely deploy your models using Azure Machine Learning. Let's get started with the demo. Now, we're going to start by deploying the model that Ami just trained and registered to the shared registry. We can use registry to make it super easy to access machine learning assets across workspaces, enabling more efficient collaboration for your team. Now, we're going to use the deployment wizard to deploy this model. And if we want more options for added configurability, we can click more options. And the first thing that I'm going to go ahead and do is, since we want a secure environment for our banking scenario, we're going to disable public network access. For the purposes of this demo, I've gone ahead and created an existing endpoint with network isolation already set so that public network access is disabled. So let's go ahead and select this endpoint. We've called it credit card fraud. And then now we're back. We'll give our deployment a name of CC new model. And we're going to enable data collection. When we enable data collection, the production inference data from our deployed model is going to be collected to our workspace blob storage. And we can use this data later for model monitoring purposes. Next, we're going to go ahead and disable egress public network access. When we disable egress public network access, it's going to block internet outbound from the deployment and only allow outbound to secured resources within our virtual network. Let's click next. And now we're going to go ahead and enable mirror traffic. We'll start by setting the traffic allocation percentage at 20%. But what is this mirror traffic thing anyways? What this means is that out of 100% of live traffic that is sent to our existing model, 20% of traffic is now copied or mirrored and sent to our new model. This allows us to test our new model's performance without disrupting anything in production. We'll create our new deployment. And now, after some time, our new deployment has succeeded. We can view a variety of metrics to see how well our model is performing in production from an operational perspective. To do so, we click View Metrics, and we can take a look at a variety of metrics, such as CPU, GPU utilization, throughput, and latency. We can even create our own custom dashboards. Now, this is really useful when we want to compare two models in production to see which one's performing better. Here we can see that our new model actually has lower average CPU utilization and lower average request latency, meaning that it's performing better than the existing model from an operational standpoint. Now, operational metrics are really useful, but what if we want to take a look at cost? Well, to take a look at cost, we can also filter based on the deployment ID, and then that will basically allow us to see which deployment is less expensive. Here we can see that the new model is performing better from both an operational standpoint and a cost standpoint. Based on these findings, we've determined it's time to deploy our new model to production. So we use mirror traffic to gradually send 100% of live traffic from the old model to the new model. And using mirror traffic, we can safely roll out all of our new models, making sure that they meet both your business and technical needs. So now that our model is successfully deployed, are we finished? Yes, actually, we're done. See you all next year. Just kidding. Nope, we're not done quite yet. Has anyone ever had their credit card declined for no reason and you had to call the bank to resolve the issue? It's definitely happened to me. I see some hands. So this would be a great example of a credit card fraud model not working well in production. We want to make sure that our credit card fraud model is working well in production to keep your customers happy. But how can we do so? Well, I'm really excited to announce that AzureML Model Monitoring is now available for public preview, enabling you to effortlessly monitor the overall health of your deployed models on AzureML. Today, I'm going to show you how you can do so with three key signals: data drift, prediction drift, and data quality. Let's dive into the demo. So we're going to start by navigating to this new monitoring section within our AzureML Studio. Here, we can create new monitors. We'll do so by clicking Add. We're going to monitor the credit card fraud model, which we just deployed and which Ami trained earlier. So let's go ahead and select that model to monitor. And then next, we have some settings we need to fill in. Not too many. We'll select the deployment, the CC new model deployment. And then we're going to go ahead and select our training data to use as our baseline data set. Now, if you remember, when we deployed our model, we enabled this thing called data collection. And this results in production inference data being collected to our AzureML workspace blob storage. This production data will be compared to our baseline training data as the basis for seeing if there's data drift among any features. Let's give our monitor a name of CC Fraud Basic Monitor. And we're going to leave the compute type as the default value of compute cluster. We'll select a cluster to use, which will be responsible for running our monitoring job on a schedule which is completely configurable to us. Since we're here in Seattle, let's select our local time of Pacific time. And let's schedule our monitor to run every weekday, Monday through Friday, at 9 a.m. PST. Once all these settings look good to us, we can go ahead and click Finish to create our new model monitor. Whoosh! 3 days have passed. And we just received this email alert telling us that there's a data quality issue showing up in our deployed model for a specific feature. What could be causing this? Well, let's take a look by navigating back to the AzureML Studio and our monitoring dashboard. We'll select the CC Fraud Basic Monitor that we just created. And here you can see in the signals menu that for the data quality signal, we have one failing test. What could this be? Well, in the notifications menu, we can see that for a specific feature, the local hour feature, the metric value of 3% is higher than the default threshold of 0%. To dive deeper into the issue, we click on the local hour feature. When we click on the local hour feature, it will bring us to the data quality signal page. And here we can take a look at the violations over time. What you'll see is that the violations start at 0% for the null value rate, but they gradually start to increase all the way up to 3%. Aha! This tells us that there's perhaps an upstream data quality issue that is showing up in our inference pipeline. Let's go ahead and bring this issue back to our team to diagnose and resolve it to mitigate any production issues. Now, this is really cool. We can set up our model monitors with these basic settings, but sometimes we want added configurability to adjust thresholds and metrics. So let's create a new model monitor, an advanced one in this case, so I can show you how this works. We create it the same way as our basic model monitor, starting by clicking Add from the monitoring dashboard. We're going to select the same model to monitor, the credit card fraud model. And we're going to input all of the same settings as we did in the basic case. We'll give our advanced monitor a name of CC Fraud Advanced Monitor so that we're able to distinguish the two. We click More Options to navigate to the advanced settings. And since all the basic settings look good to us, we click Next. Now, in the Configure Dataset menu, we can select what data we want to use to monitor our model. In this example, we have one training baseline data set, and then we have two production data assets, our model inputs and our model outputs. And those data assets are being updated in real time automatically for you by the data collector. Next, we go to the signals menu, and here we can change a variety of things related to the signals that are monitoring our model's health. For the data drift signal, let's click edit, and we're going to change the name to data drift signal ADV. We'll go ahead and select the target column of isFraud, and for all numerical features, let's set the threshold value to be 0.3. We can always change this later. We're using some specific metrics, one for numerical features and one for categorical features. Again, we can always change this later if we would like to. For prediction drift, we go ahead and edit the signal. We're going to change the name to prediction drift signal ADV. Everything else looks good to us, so let's click save. And lastly, let's dive into the data quality signal, click edit, change the name to data quality signal ADV, and let's say that we're only interested in monitoring for null values. We don't care about the other checks in this case, so we're going to go ahead and unselect them. Once we're ready, we click save, and we click next. Now, in the notifications menu, and this is one of my favorite menus here, you can go ahead and select which email addresses receive email alerts. It can be one or multiple. You can also configure alerting through Azure Monitor. Let's review all of those settings. They look great to us, so we click create. Whoosh, a month has passed, and we just received this email alert notifying us that there's a data drift issue in our deployed model for a specific feature. Let's navigate back to the monitoring dashboard and see what's going on in this case. So we go back to the monitoring dashboard, and this time we select our CC Fraud Advanced Monitor. In the signals menu, you can see that we have an issue showing up for our data drift signal that we've created. Now, in the notifications menu for that specific feature, you can see that the metric value of 0.32 is just above the current threshold of 0.3. And we're referring to the transaction amount USD feature in this case. Let's dive deeper by clicking on the feature. And here we can take a look at data drift over time. We have 1 month of past metric data, so we can see those data points over the past week. But since we have a month, let's go back a month by clicking 1 month to view 1 month of past metric data. And here we can see a gradual increase in data drift showing up for this specific feature. Now, this is really useful, but what if we want to take a look at the underlying data distributions to see what's causing this issue? To do so, we can select the feature and take a look at the feature breakdown. Here we can see the target or production distribution for this feature compared to the baseline or training distribution of the same feature. We can see that the two distributions have different statistical properties, so it makes sense to us why data drift was detected in this case. Now, with all this information, it might be time to retrain our model to make sure that it's performing well in production. So let's go ahead and bring this back to the team to figure out what's going on. Thanks. I'm going to pass it back to Shané.
Thank you, Alex, and thank you, Ami, for a wonderful presentation on some of the amazing features you just saw. So make sure you check out the stuff that you just saw. It's currently available, from the network isolation to the VS Code improvements, all the way to model monitoring in production. All right, so I promised demos, right? We're on to our second demo. And this demo is really interesting because we're going to show you a new feature, and it's called Manage Feature Store. And Manage Feature Store is great because it improves the reliability and agility of shipping your models. And this is important, especially in large organizations or organizations looking to scale. And I have one of my colleagues, Sethu, who's going to talk a little bit about this in a second. He's going to talk about how we can discover, reuse, and even create features. And he's also going to explain what even are these feature things, and what is a feature store, and show you how you can use it in the model. So take it away, Sethu.
Thank you, Shané. Let me provide some context before we jump into the demo. What are features? Features serve as inputs for the models, often computed from enterprise data such as customer clicks or order information. Features are the connective tissue in the ML lifecycle, from prototyping to training to operationalizing. However, without a feature management system, our customers face various challenges. Number one, experimentation is inefficient due to lack of feature reuse and dependency on external teams for data and tensor features. Two, there is additional operational overhead for ML teams to build custom infrastructure for feature materialization and monitoring. And three, reduced model reliability due to inconsistent feature definitions and lack of versioning support. Updating feature definitions can potentially break existing models in production. Now let me show you how Azure ML Managed Feature Store can help here. The demo scenario is that, as a data scientist, I would like to improve the performance of my fraud model by incorporating new features that are based on enterprise data. As a first step, I want to find features that I can use in my model. Here you can see the list of feature stores that I have access to. Let's explore the retail feature store. Feature sets are a set of features grouped together. Here I can see two feature sets, transactions and accounts, already created by my team. Also notice that these are versioned. Let's start exploring the transactions feature set. Here, I can see the list of features in this feature set. These are rolling window aggregates of transactions sum, amount, and average for 7 days and 3 days interval. I believe these can be useful features to improve the model performance. I can also see that materialization is enabled for this feature set along with a user-specified schedule. The system transparently runs managed pipelines to pre-compute the features and makes it available for training and inference for efficient lookup. Let us now switch to the project workspace. This is a managed Spark notebook in Azure ML that I can use to develop and experiment with features. As a first step, I'm selecting the set of features that I would like to experiment with. You can see I have two features from the account feature set and three from the transaction feature set. Next, I save this list of features and its versions in a portable YAML format called Feature Retrieval Spec. As you will see, this will help with faster experimentation. The next cell runs the training pipeline. Let's inspect it. The pipeline has multiple steps. Let's start by looking at the two inputs, the feature retrieval spec that we just saw and the input observation data. Let's look at the observation data. This has information captured during the time of the transaction, including the transaction ID, amount, and the timestamp. The target also has been appended to this. The feature retrieval component is a built-in component that takes the observation data and enhances this with the features to generate the training data. This is how the training data looks like. You can see that the feature data is joined with the observation data. Note that this uses a point-in-time join that avoids data leakage and helps produce reliable models. The next step is the training step that takes the training data as input and generates the model as the output. The next step evaluates the model performance, and finally, the model register step registers the model. Let's inspect the registered model. You can see that the feature retrieval spec is packaged along with the model. What we started during prototyping is now part of the model artifact. You will see shortly how this will be used during inference. Newer version of models can use newer version of features and can be deployed without disrupting the older version of the model. Now let's head back to the notebook again. If you'd like to experiment further, select a new set of features, update the feature retrieval spec, and run the training pipeline. But now let's move on to the next step that kicks off the batch inference pipeline. Let's inspect it. The inputs to the pipeline are the fraud model and the observation data for inference. The feature retrieval step pulls in the feature retrieval spec from the fraud model and joins the features with the observation data and produces the input data for batch inference. The inference step performs the scoring. Let's inspect the output of the inference. You can see the prediction here. This concludes the demo. We saw how Feature Store helps experiment faster by reusing features and leveraging portable representation of features, reduce operational cost by using managed materialization, and improve model reliability by leveraging versioning and point-in-time joins.
Thank you so much, Sethu, for joining us virtually. And I want to talk a little bit about Belfius, one of our customers in the financial industry. And they've been using Azure Machine Learning Managed Feature Store. And they've actually reported that their models are now more robust, more performant. And they're really, really excited about their partnership with Azure Machine Learning and Microsoft. So thank you very much, Belfius, for your partnership. And we look forward to continue working with you in the future. And Managed Feature Store, as you saw in the demo, is now public preview. So make sure you check it out and tell us what you think. And now for our final demo of the day. I know, right? Time flies when you're having fun. And we're going to show you how you can leverage open source models in your machine learning workflow. And if you're like me, I don't really like starting from scratch and building my model from the ground up. I want to choose something that's already available and really fine tune it and really focus on the things that matter, right? Like applying that model in production. So I'm going to call Ami back up on stage, who's going to talk a little bit more about the open source models in Azure Machine Learning.
Hello, thanks, Shané. I'm back again for another demo. As you saw yesterday in the keynote, we talked a lot about foundation models. And today, I'm going to be showing you how to build and operationalize those foundation models at scale. And it can be challenging, don't get me wrong. That's why Azure ML is here to provide you with a comprehensive and powerful platform to overcome these challenges with faster hardware, model evaluation, and fine-tuning components, and a comprehensive repository of language models. You'll have the tools you need to succeed. So let's take a look at this feature and play the video. Here, we have landed in our model catalog in Azure ML Studio. We've curated and integrated the top open source pre-trained models that you have full control over. And let's say you can't find the model you're looking for whatever reason, it's just not there. There's an import model button available at the top right where you can easily import models from Hugging Face and leverage the powerful evaluation, fine-tuning, and deployment components of Azure ML. So no worries there. Now let's talk about what we're going to do here today. I want to build a conversational question and answering application for literature. It's going to be aimed at helping book readers find and connect with books in a more meaningful way. Our model catalog offers many question and answering models here. As you can see, I've been filtered down to them by clicking the task filter on the right. I'm going to go ahead and look at one of them. I'm going to choose this distilled squad model. Here, I've landed in the model card, where there's a lot of information on what this model is about, inferencing examples, fine-tuning samples, and notebooks and CLI with YAML. And there's also a playground. I want to try it out. I'm going to add a question. That's one of my examples. Who is Harry Potter? And add some context. I've gotten a result here that kind of just takes the first sentence. So I kind of can see how this model is working. But I want to know how it's working across my entire data set. So here, what I'm going to do is I'm going to evaluate this model. I'm going to click on the evaluate button, which opens up the wizard, and choose my test data. I already have a data set pre-registered, so I can easily go ahead and click on that data set. And in here, I just need to map that data by clicking on the appropriate columns. I click question, content, answer. And for compute, I'm going to leverage that same serverless compute I talked about earlier. So I don't even need to really worry about, you know, managing, figuring out how many GPUs I need. I easily click serverless, and from there, I will go ahead and then submit my evaluation training job. Now that I've submitted this evaluation job, this will take some time, and to save us some time, I've gone ahead and, you know, submitted a few evaluation jobs ahead of time so we can see how many of the models in our library have performed against this data set. And I'm going to jump back into that experiment. Here, I can see the exact match in F1 scores of the model against my data set. I can see that DeepSet Roberta Base Squad 2 is performing very close, has a very high exact match score, and also F1 score. And there's also the other model I was using earlier, the Distilbert one. So they're both performing pretty good, but they're not exactly up to my mark. So what I'm going to go ahead and do here is fine-tune those models. So I'm going to select my training data by already going to my registered data set and adding that here. I'm going to go ahead and map those data columns as well as I've done earlier into the evaluation step. It's very similar process, very easy. And from there, I'm gonna click add. And I'm also gonna, I also can do a separate validation data and test data set if I would like. But for the sake of this demo, I'm gonna go ahead and use an automatic split of my training data. And again, I'm going to be using serverless. From here, I'm gonna finish up and submit my fine-tuning job. Great. So I've submitted this fine-tuning job, and now I wanna compare how both of those fine-tuning jobs have performed. And I'm gonna go back to that dashboard view once it's ready. And here I can see that the DeepSet Roberta squad model has reduced the loss better compared to the DeepSet BRK. So with that said, I now can think about how I wanna leverage this model into my application. I wanna deploy it. There are many ways from here I can do that. I can go ahead and click on that model, register it, and as I've shown earlier, go ahead and go through deployment wizard. But let's say that the base model is good enough for me, that the base model served its purpose. From that model card, I can easily click deploy to an online endpoint, and in one click, I'm ready to leverage that open source model in my application. Everything's pre-filled for me and ready to go. Just in one click, I have this endpoint created, which will take a few minutes, but for the sake of this demo, I've spun some things up quicker, and I can use this in my application. So with that said, I've shown you how you can take an open source model, quickly deploy it, but you can also evaluate, fine-tune, and do so much more, all with the power of Azure ML. So I'm very happy to say that this is now in public preview, and I hope you all get to try it and see how you use it today. Back to Shané.
Thank you, Ami. And as Ami said, check it out in public preview today. So I can't show all of this great goodness in Azure Machine Learning without really talking about what our customers are doing. And today we see 7,000 customers using Azure Machine Learning and thousands of users using it every single day. In addition to direct users, we have ISVs such as DataRobot and SIs working directly with about 10,000 partners implementing Azure AI solutions. And while a lot of these customers are building and training models, the job really isn't done until you take that model and you put it in production and you start scoring against it or making inferencing requests against that model, right? I'm happy to announce that today we see about 300 billion inferencing requests per month on the Azure Machine Learning platform. Yeah, y'all could clap for that. That's a pretty big number, 300 billion inferencing requests. So definitely want to say thank you to the customers that are using the product today. And you know, we could feature your story or your case study sometime in the near future. Let's say maybe build 2024 next year. So thank you so much. We look forward to working with new customers and existing ones. There's one customer in particular, though, I want to call out, and that is Swift. Swift is a financial firm, and they're working on building an accurate anomaly detection model. They're using Azure Machine Learning and Federated Learning and actually running their workloads on Azure Confidential Computing. If you want to learn more about what exactly Azure Confidential Computing is, make sure you check out the AMD and Intel pages. And I'm going to play a quick video so you can see exactly what Swift is doing today.
Nothing good comes from financial crime. It causes banks and financial institutions to run fairly large operational efforts to be able to monitor, to be able to resolve, investigate financial crimes as they happen.
Swift is a global company. We connect 11,000 financial institutions around the globe to our network.
We offer the standards for financial institutions and banks to communicate. So we're in a really unique position to bring the industry together to try to solve some of the most complex problems because of who we are and what we do. We're not naive enough to think we can do it alone. What's really important in these partnerships is alignment of values. And I think with Microsoft, we have that. In addition, Bank of New York Mellon have been fantastic innovative partners for Swift for a long time.
Preventing financial crime is a problem that we cannot solve individually as a bank, that we need to solve collectively. And working with SWIFT, other financial institutions, and Microsoft, we really believe is the right path to make progress quickly.
Our first ambition is to build a foundation model for anomaly detection that underpins the detection and prevention of fraud, and collaborating with Microsoft and our member banks to stop fraud occurring in payments. We are exploring the federated learning aspects of Azure's machine learning offering. We take a model developed by SWIFT and further train and enrich it through the Azure Confidential Computing platform, whereby we can train an Azure machine learning model on multiple distributed data sets. We're realizing that there are additional data points that our member banks have, which will further drive the accuracy of the anomaly detection models.
This gives us the ability to monitor the transaction flow across the SWIFT network so the banks can actually figure out how they can use it to do things like eliminate fraud in their networks and the segments that they cover.
The fight against fraud really is a space where collaboration is key. So working together with SWIFT and with Microsoft gives us the opportunity to create better solutions for our clients collectively than we actually could do individually.
We actually believe that we can build the most accurate, most performant anomaly detection model for financial services that's ever been created.
We will be able to protect payments around the world. We will be able to reuse these technologies in all types of domains, from healthcare, governments protecting their citizen data. Confidential computing will make the world such a better place.
We're still working through design, but the outcomes up to now and the results that we're finding are very promising.
Okay, and if any of you have questions about today's session or about Azure Machine Learning in general, make sure you come check out our discussion and Q&A today at 5:15. That's the first one listed here. And we'll try to answer your questions, and if we can't, we'll just simply ignore your question or pretend we didn't see it or hear you. And make sure you check out some of the other cool sessions. There are pretty amazing things happening all around build. And what's next? Make sure you get connected, connect with me, connect with the other presenters, learn about Azure Machine Learning, test out some of the new features. We showed you a bunch of awesome stuff, ranging from how you could secure your workspace, to monitor your model in production, to VS Code, you name it. So make sure you check out some of the things that are available. And we just want to thank you for coming to our session today, both in person and online. And we look forward to seeing you next year. Thank you.